context with your specific target groups and so on. That's why quality in learning education and training is always adaptation to your specific situation. That is most important for you, and that's why I said I could end now here. But I'd like at least also to share some other aspects and thoughts that that are with me, because I believe there's something more to add than such a general statement here. Okay, coming back to the original question, are innovations and ICT opportunities or contradictions? Well, we have heard a lot in the past and also here at the conference that there are disruptive technologies now, also leading to disruptive situations, to a disruptive society or disruptive societies even. The question is, do we also have disruptive learning now? And have we to change education and training to reflect such disruptive learning? Well, let me first start with a question: what is more important, learning innovations or learning quality? And the answer from me is simple. If you're looking at innovations versus quality, we have first to state that the learning history should not be ignored. Even so, we have wonderful innovations, a dramatic change in society, disruptive technologies, we have always to learn from our experiences. Second statement, currently learning technologies are mainly technology driven. And we have had the question already yesterday, why should we use technologies? We should not use technologies only because they are available. There should be a meaning and there should be an objective to use technologies. Then it makes sense. And finally, third statement, learning is not completely changing. Even though we have a lot of progress in biotechnologies and in examining the brains, you can see a lot of different pictures of the brain sectors and so on. Maybe the sectors in our brains that are affected by learning processes are changing a little bit. But that is only at a lower level. What is not changing is that learning is only done by yourself. You cannot force anybody to learn. It's always you who can learn, and you can now continue here sitting in front of me and thinking about, oh, I'm not at all interested in what he is saying, and you will never learn something from my speech here, and you can completely ignore that. And as an educator, you have always to be aware of it. The good educators are always aware of that, of course, yeah. But we have always to keep in mind when you're talking about the impact of innovations and ICT, learning is not changing. You can only build the environment. You can give opportunities to your students, to your learners, but they have still to learn by themselves. And if you're not convincing them, if you're not motivating them, then you're failing. Okay, if you put that on a diagram, I tried to explain that also in such a feature, and if you have the time at the bottom and then the quantity of quality, it's the second dimension, then we could say, comparing history, now and future, we have always had something that learning processes, education and training was improving step by step, learning from the past and so on. Now, there's a saying something is happening, learning 2.0 or even 3.0 is similar to web 2.0 or web 3.0. And that is claiming that now innovations should take place that are coming from the scratch and should change everything radically. But the big question is then, how can you argue that there is now such a jump from our learning history towards such a new way of innovations? But on the other hand, you cannot ignore that there are these opportunities of innovations. And for that reason, if you don't reflect them and integrate them in your future education training, then the quality of your education training will decrease because you're not benefiting and taking advantage of their opportunities. And finally, as you could maybe already imagine, my recommendation is to do the mixing learning innovations and learning history, learning from the past. Okay, that is also hopefully something that you can still follow and go with me. Let's go on. Still the question, what is quality? First answer is quality is most important for learning, education, and training. If you look at different dimensions of quality, then we have to combine the history together with the potential of the standards for the reusing of solutions from the past, as well as innovations. And that will hopefully lead for a complete picture of the quality in learning, education, and training. And that means we have to address the processes for learning, education, and training to improve the quality. Of course, we have also addressed the results, the learning outcomes, and the competences that we would like to achieve, that the learners are building them. But we have also to think about the potential. And that is most important. You should not design a learning opportunity by just reflecting what's happened in the past, what are the learning objectives, and how we can easily achieve them. You should always think about what could be the best and optimal potential learning progress of the learners. And that could also lead to completely change of learning design that you have used during the last years. And this is a concept that is coming from a quality management for introducing a continuous improvement cycle. And actually that was developed by Donabedian already in the 80s for the healthcare sector. And it's based on the concept from Uran and Deming that they have introduced in Japan and then transferred to America and the other countries worldwide. But this is still valid in our days. The potential is this dimension that is sometimes forgotten. And that is also the dimension that is even offering the biggest opportunities for the future. Okay, quality, most important. And I'd like also to say a new pedagogy is also as important as the quality. But what does that mean? It does not mean that there is a need for completely new theory, but a pedagogy that is taking benefit of the opportunities by innovation and ICT. Coming back, how to improve quality in education. And here's something I have to add, and I was very happy to have that reference in not only your presentation, but in many presentations yesterday and today. We should not forget learning processes are always dealing with motivation, with joy. Otherwise, the learners will not decide to follow the learning processes, to learn by themselves. That's why we need learning opportunities also with fun. Okay. That is still my question, opportunities or contradiction? Let's have a look more into the field of innovations. what kind of innovations are we talking about, and what could be also applied in future education and training. We had a lot of buzzwords and hype cycles during the last years, even not decades, and some of them are appearing, some of them are disappearing, some of them are continuing. That is not my point here. If we have all these buzzwords and hype terms, the question is, are they learning innovations and are they ensuring a better quality in learning, education, and training? If you look on the timeline, we have had the past, we are now in the middle where the learning opportunity should take place, and looking towards the future where innovations should happen. Are these the innovations for learning, education, and training? My answer is no, they are not, because these concepts were already developed several years ago, several decades ago, some of them even several hundred years ago or even thousands of years ago. And if you look on some educators and other researchers and scientists from diverse disciplines, and you will definitely know Vygotsky here from the Russian Federation as one of the pioneers here, but you can see also a lot of others, starting with Aristotle and Plato. Think about what they have already done to innovate learning, education, and training in the past. That is incredible, and these dialogue principles are still valid. What are you doing in online tutoring? It should be a dialogue. You should not tell the people how they should behave or what they should do, but you should give them the opportunity to learn, to explore by themselves step by step. And it's not only about a European way. That's why I have also put Confucius here. We are very pleased to have a keynote this year by Professor Su Xiting from the ECNU in Shanghai. He was introducing how Confucius and his theory and concepts are still influencing the way how smart education in China is developed and designed. Okay, that means all these buzzwords are only tools and hypes. They are not replacing a pedagogy. That's why I'd like to state there is no disruptive learning. And by the way, I'd like also to add something. There are also no digital natives. Just to tell you at least what we have found out in Central Europe, maybe that is not valid for all parts of the world. I can only tell you about Central Europe. We have done a study and compared the progress of digital competences and the use of digital devices and ICT by young children in Central Europe. And we have still a significant percentage of children who cannot carefully and reflectingly using the devices and ICT. That is not something that they are learning from birth. Some of them are doing it. Some of them have easy access to new tools, to new devices, to new ICT. But some of them are still failing. And that is a question for learning, education, and training for all, for inclusive learning. That's why I'm always highlighting that. Forget the term digital natives. We have many, but there's not such a generation of all children that are digital natives. Okay. My most important statement is pedagogy is key for learning success with strategy, vision, and ideas, and not tools and hypes. I hope that I could convince you with that, and that you are also trying to achieve a future learning education and training that is aiming to increase the quality of the learning processes. To round up that speech, I will rush through many slides. Just to point you to some tools, frameworks, some projects, some ongoing initiatives that may be interesting for you. And if you're interested, please talk to me during the coffee break and I can explore more to you about some of them. Okay, frameworks and tools. What is available? We have got RFDQ, the first international learning quality standard, developed by the International Standardization Organization ISO, and that was already done in 2005. It's about a process model that you can adapt to your specific situation according to 7 process categories and 38 processes, and they are also divided into sub-processes. A wonderful tool just for designing your learning processes. IDEAL, a framework for learning quality and competence development that is an integration to introduce both at the same time. And just to show you how this IDEAL is working, it is like the RFDQ the cycle that was developed by a scholar of Deming, the so-called Deming cycle, Plan, Do, Check, Act. Here it's called Initiate, Do, Evaluate, and Act, to put also the learner into the core. And here you can find how that is brought down also to subcategories, what you have always to reflect here. EPhi, the Evaluation Framework for Impact Assessment, is something that is combining impact assessment within an organization as well as the external impact assessment, even including the impact on the society.
Just to to say that time is over, colleague Strache.
Okay.
Several minutes yet.
Okay, thank you. Then I will just run through. Innovations in education, we have e-learning that is just normalizing now. We have MOOCs that are coming now, and that is sometimes also leading to a variety of MOOCs that are looking very easy and same. But big advantage of MOOCs is mass marketing for e-learning. Open learning, I think it's most important to address in the future. The question is how to define open. We have the initiative Opening Up Education that was already introduced earlier today by the European Commission. And open learning is a combination of open learning styles and open learning scenarios. Innovations in education, well, bottom-up approach is most important to follow here. And we have 2 projects for learning innovations, ODS and Inspiring Science Education, with several thousand of schools in 15 languages and with 28 countries. I cannot speak about that now. We have the innovation model here that is introducing that following a cycle of stimulation, trials, incubation, scenarios, acceleration. And open learning for future learning can be done at this classroom, in universities, and in lifelong learning. If you want to participate, maybe there are some opportunities here at the LINK conference that is taking place every year on combining learning innovations and learning quality. Also ended up with a declaration of Crete on openness, the reestablishment of openness. It was also the place where ICAR was created, the International Council for Open Research and Open Education. And the next event of ICAR will be at the ICCE conference in Nara in Japan. Maybe you can join here, 1st of December. And conclusions, opportunities or contradiction? Of course, innovation and ICT are offering new and huge opportunities. I did not want to say that there is a contradiction. Quality education can be facilitated through innovation and ICT. But my main point, of course, is quality education through ICT through innovation and ICT is based on ICT and innovation as a means, as a tool, as a supportive mechanism. Change in education is needed, and quality should be at the core, and quality in education with fun. That's why you will find also further information. I'd like to end up with my vision. I hope that I could convince you, that I could also convince you about the vision of open learning as a future way that we have opening up our learning environments towards an inclusive education and training for all in the future. And I would really appreciate if we could do that together in the future. And I thank you very much for your attention.
Very interesting presentation, but no time for question, unfortunately. You have to continue. Question in a break. Спасибо большое, профессор Штраке. Очень интересное представление. Сейчас профессор Михаил Меймарис, директор лаборатории новых коммуникационных технологий в образовании и средствах массовой информации Афинский университет Греции. Жизнь человека и в эпоху битов и байтов. Now, the floor is
Thank you, Mr.
will be
Chairman.
Given to Professor Michael Meimaris, Director of the New Technologies Laboratory in Communication, Education and the Mass Media, University of Athens, Greece, Being Human Through Bits and Bytes. You have a floor, Professor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, I'm very happy to be with you here in Moscow. As a new member of the governing board of the UNESCO IITE, I would like to take the opportunity of our conference and through my speech introduce also myself. In the early 70s, after receiving my first degree in mathematics from the University of Athens, I was drawn to data analysis, which I studied in Paris. Next to the pioneer of multidimensional data analysis methods, Professor Jean-Paul Benzekri. My choice to study data analysis on a postgraduate level and later on embrace this subject as my main research field originated from the allure of the early efforts to listen through the use of computers to what data had to say. An attempt to listen to the data themselves, to listen to their stories, rather than trying to put meaning into them by squeezing them in probability models and statistical schemas. So really early in my professional life, I was interested in the commonplace where MOOCs, mobiles, and the cloud, that is data in general, converge. Indeed, in the core of the massive open online courses concept lies the cloud, the very existence of anything that is both massive and online needs the interconnected resources which cloud computing provides nowadays. Using innovative combinations of cloud, mobile, and collaborative technologies, MOOCs are able to deliver entire curricula at least or no cost to education consumers. Accordingly, separate clouds being hybrid, public or private, large scale or small scale, they jointly form the vague yet easily understood in everyday language concept of the cloud. Clouds are part of a cloud. In the same line of thinking, mobile devices are the faster growing medium people use to access the cloud. Mobiles are used among other services, to store, retrieve, and share data in the cloud. Why is the cloud always depicted as a natural cloud? We assume it is because, just like the natural one, the technological cloud is constantly changing. New machinery and, of course, new data is added every single minute to it, while at the same time, existing hardware, software, and content is removed. But the sheer fact is that the cloud keeps growing, both in terms of processing power and in terms of amount of data. Already, there is a vast amount of data out there. We need to utilize this data for the sake of understanding the human condition and build better education for the forthcoming generations based on our knowledge of the world. In order to do that, we must keep data open and we must try to link them. We need our ever-growing big data to be open data and linked data. Open data ensures that everyone will have access to the raw elements of knowledge, and linked data helps us keep the streamline of information running. Tim Berners-Lee outlined the single most precious attribute to linked data. With linked data, when you have some of it, you can find other related data. It is just a matter of getting the stream running. The use of the adjective precious with respect to linked data was intentional. As the Vice President of the European Commission, Neelie Kroes, argued, data really is the new oil. Data is a raw material for information businesses, just as oil is a raw material for fuel and plastic businesses. Data is also everywhere. It is cheap, and it can deliver huge rewards. Unlike oil, though, which is an exhaustible resource, the more we use data, the more their value increases. That is why, while in industrial societies and economies, the basic model of value creation is the limitation of access to resources, in the knowledge society, free and open access to information is the prerequisite for development. All these data, the interminable lines of zero and one, more and more often constitute a multimedia product in our mediated era. A product comprised of still images, video, music, sounds, text, graphic designs, etc. And all this data that is now stored in the cloud, accessed usually through mobile devices, uploaded to MOOCs, is a set of information that we are expected to use not only by analyzing it in order to understand it, like I used to do in the 70s in Paris through the graphics of analyse factorielle de correspondance and classification automatique. We were expected to understand it not only as graphic images, which if we had consulted them in the first place, maybe the challenger would not have been destroyed, but understand it as the primal matter that will ignite the necessary engagement of both teachers and students in the 21st century. In education, the term student engagement has grown in popularity in recent decades, most likely resulting from an increased understanding of the role that certain intellectual, emotional, behavioral, physical, and social factors play in the learning process. A wide variety of research studies on learning have revealed connections between the so-called non-cognitive factors or non-cognitive skills, for example, motivation, interest, curiosity, responsibility, determination, perseverance, attitude, work habits, self-regulation, social skills, etc., and cognitive learning results, for example, improved academic performance, test scores, information recall, skill acquisition, etc. Engagement is thought to be a sine qua non aspect of our mediated, through especially digital games and social media, time, not only for digital natives, but for digital immigrants and foreigners as well. So, what we are expected to do is use a highly personalized way that steers up engagement in every single one of them. I'm sorry. Indeed, nowadays, students have grown up in a framework of constant connectivity and interactive culture, and thus may have different attitudes and understandings of concepts such as creativity, collaboration, communication, sharing. This behavior should have arguably led to reforming the institutions of learning and education. What kind of educational environments could be created, fused with the values of collaboration and meaningful communication, which are pillars of the commons-oriented open source movement? Could these scenarios and environments be considered as objects to think with, as Papert used to say, which would contribute to the social process of constructing the education of the future? At the Laboratory of New Technologies in Communication, Education, and the Mass Media, which I direct at the University of Athens, by embracing this line of thinking, we put forward theory as well as applications in the areas of serious games and digital game-based learning, of adaptive and personalized systems and network, of digital storytelling. I would like to elaborate a bit more on this tool, digital storytelling, that through the use of free of charge or really cheap software, the use of the internet, digital photos and videos, easily, as we know, accessible features in any smartphone nowadays, allows us to create our multimedia story, thus transforming us into creative storytellers, and what is more, with digital skills. Digital storytelling is available to everyone, from school to university, from intellectuals to even illiterate people. And we know how important this can be for a large number of the 194 member states of UNESCO. Younger or older citizens, men or women, without any cultural or other boundaries, discriminations, or limitations. Digital storytelling can be applied to a wide range of areas and purposes, such as, let me find out that slide because it's a little in another position. Yes. So, such as telling an organization's story, reflective practice, health and human services, intergenerational connection, disability, youth problems, identity and diversity, activism, international development, K-12 and higher education curricula, scenario planning, futures thinking, personal reflection, team building, journalism, technology training, urban planning, etc. Let me go back. I'm sorry about that. In learning environment, capturing the interest of the learners is the first step towards achieving knowledge. We hear that many times today and yesterday. The contribution of digital storytelling to this end can take two forms. It can either derive from the educator facilitator or from the learners themselves. Stories created by educators aspire to increase the curiosity of the learners in the exploration of new topics, concepts, and ideas, while laying the field for a free and productive discussion on the issues addressed. When learners are assigned the creation of their own digital stories, their active involvement enhances their research skills and critical ability, helps them improve the way they organize, express, and communicate their ideas, as well as evaluate without judging their own work as well as that of others. The process of creating digital stories equips learners with the so-called 21st century skills, also known as digital age literacies, that is the digital, global, technology, visual and information literacies in general. Acquiring this set of skills is considered crucial for today's citizens who are expected to meet the highly demanding requirements of our interconnected societies and markets. By creatively associating data, we provide them with a connective tissue that results in structuring a story. These digital narratives, through the multiple canals of multimedia product, stimulate our various, in the words of Howard Gardner, intelligence, and thus we can achieve, and we have proof of these achievements over the years, impressive learning results. At this moment, let us let the stories tell their story. Can we have the first video, please? Can we put the lights a little?
Εγώ είμαι γεννητής 2.11.38 στην Αθήνα. Εκείνα τα χρόνια ήταν πάρα πολύ δύσκολα χρόνια στην Αθήνα. Εμείς πεινούσαμε, υποφέραμε, διότι δεν μπορούσαμε να ζήσουμε. Δεν είχαμε χωριά να έχουμε κότηση. Και πεινάσαμε. Είχα μια αδερφή την... που αυτή εκείνη γεννήθηκε μέσα στον πόλεμο. Και η μαμά μου, για να λυτερωθούμε από τους Γερμανούς, την έκαναμε και νικήσα. Ήμουν ένα ζωηρό παιδί, αλλά ζωηρό πάρα πολύ για τον αθλητισμό, για τις γυμναστικές. Και δεν είχα πουθενά να με βοηθήσει κανένας. Πήγαινα σχολείο με ένα τετράδιο και με ένα μολύβι. Και ήμουν η πρώτη μαθήτρια. Έβγαλε με 9,5 το εγγυητικό που έβγαλε. Δεν είχαμε ούτε να φάμε. Περιμέναμε να έρθει η Κυριακή για να φάμε μακαρόνια, ήταν το καλό μας φαΐ. Η μαμά μου μας έβαζε 6 παιδιά, μας έβαζε ψωμί και πάνω στο ψωμί μας έβαζε ζάχαρη και νερό για να μπορέσουμε να φάμε να μεγαλώσουμε. Το καλό μας φαΐ ήταν τα μακαρόνια. Περάσαμε τα χρόνια. Εμένα μου άρεσε πάρα πολύ ο αθλητισμός. Όταν πήγαινα στο σχολείο, στο δημοτικό, εκείνα τα χρόνια, ήμουν η πρώτη αθλήτρια. Πηγαίνοντας στο σχολείο, μόλις τελειώσω το σχολείο, έδωσα για να πάω στο γυμνάσιο και ο μπαμπάς μου με έστειλε να πάω στη φάμπρικα. πήγαινα στην ελληνική τεχνική μετάξη Αθηνών και έπλεχα και έπλεχα και έκανα και μετάξη. Εγώ δεν μπορούσα να το ανοιχτώ αυτό από μικρό κοριτσά και από 12 χρόνια μισή κάπηκα. Και πήγαινα σε ένα σύλλογο αθλητικό και πήγαινα και γυμναζόμουν. 17 χρονών έφερα το πρώτο μετάλλιο άλμα εις ύψος. Εκείνα τα χρόνια πήγαινα στη Νέα Σμύρνη με ένα σύλλογο και με πήγε στη Νέα Σμύρνη και γυμναζόμουν και έφερα το πρώτο μετάλλιο. Ο μπαμπάς μου ήταν πολύ βάναυσος, μου σπάσε μια καρέκλα στην πλάτη μου και με κλείδωσε 3 ημέρες μέσα και δεν με άφηνε να βγω γιατί έφερα το μετάλλιο και γιατί βγήκε και δεν τον ρώτησα. Όμως εγώ δεν το βάλα κάτω. Πάλι συνέχισε τη ζωή μου και έλεγα κάποτε θα μου το πληρώσεις. Το έλεγα όμως με την καλή την έννοια γιατί εγώ ήμουν επαναστάτηση. Ήμουν μια κοπέλα η οποία είχα μέσα μου ζωντάνια. Είχα έναν αέρα, είχα να χορεύω, είχα να διασκεδάζω και όλα πήγαινα μου τα κλείσει ο μπαμπάς μου. Εκείνα τα χρόνια του 60 φεύγανε για τη Γερμανία και κάποια μου δούλευα στο εργοστάσιο ότι στην Αθήνα Πανεπιστημίου βγάζουν, λέει, διαβατήρια και φεύγουν. Και εγώ κρυφά πήγα και έβγαλα διαβατήριο και μία μέρα διαμέσου Πάτρας και Αγκώνας και μετά με το τρένο ένα απόγευμα χαιρέτησε τη μαμάκα μου που την υπέρ αγαπούσα και τα αδέλφια μου και το έσκασα για τη Γερμανία. Πήγα στην Πάτρα και από εκεί πήγαμε για την Αγκώνα και από εκεί πήγαμε μετά από άλλη πήγαμε να πάμε Γερμανία. Ήμουν ένα κοριτσάκι τότε 24 χρόνων γεμάτο όνειρα και ελπίδες. Μέσα στο καράβι πέρασα πάρα πολλά γιατί ήμουν μια κατάξαντη.
Okay. Mrs. Amalia, a lady of 70 plus years old, gave this interview to George, a 12 years old boy, and then the two of them put together the video you just saw as part of one of many projects we have implemented, focusing on intergenerational communication and learning. They work together, each one with their own skills, choosing and then downloading the music score, choosing and scanning photos from her personal albums, etc. This way, Mrs. Amalia realized not only that she had to gain from the digital world, but also, and this is of grave importance, and what motivated her to learn more about the technologies involved, that she has a lot to give to the digital world surrounding her based on her experience. In our next example, a teacher, having been trained in the concept and methods of digital storytelling, acts as the facilitator and introduces his young student, an immigrant from Syria, to digital technology through the opportunity to tell his personal story. Can we have the second video, please?
Και γεννήθηκα στην Ελλάδα. Οι γονείς μου είναι από τη Συρία. Τώρα στην οικονομική κρίση κατάλαβα ότι εδώ πια είμαι ξένος. Επειδή κάποιοι μπορούν να μου κάνουν κακό αν δουν το πρόσωπό μου, όση ώρα μιλάω θα βλέπετε αυτή την εικόνα. Ανάμεσα σε άλλες εικόνες που έχω διαλέξει. Συνοχωριέμαι που δεν έχουμε λεφτά όπως παλιά και δεν έχουμε ζέστη τώρα το χειμώνα στο σπίτι μας. Συνοχωριέμαι που στο μαγαζί του μπαμπά δεν έρχονται πελάτες όπως πριν. Ο μπαμπάς πουλάει πράγματα που αρέσουν στους Άραβες, αλλά πολλοί έχουν φύγει με την κρίση. Πιο πολύ όμως συνοχωριέμαι για αυτά που γίνονται στη Συρία. Εκεί πολλοί άνθρωποι, γυναίκες και παιδιά, σκοτώνονται κάθε μέρα. Δείτε αυτές τις εικόνες.
It was all made by Ziad with the facilitator teacher.
Εγώ έχω συνηθίσει να βλέπω τέτοια πράγματα στο ίντερνετ, στις ειδήσεις από τη Συρία, κάθε μέρα. Φοβάμαι πως δεν θα ξαναδώ πολλούς από τους συγγενείς μου. Τελικά υπάρχει και χειρότερο πράγμα από την οικονομική κρίση. Γι' αυτό είναι ο πόλεμος. Πολλές φορές κλαίω κρυφά στο και ρωτάω. Γιατί, Θεέ μου? Ο μπαμπάς μου λέει ότι ο πόλεμος είναι καλός για λίγους και κακός για τους πολλούς. Αλήθεια, αυτό, αλήθεια, δεν το καταλαβαίνω. Αν συναντούσα αυτούς που έχουν κάνει τα πράγματα να είναι έτσι στην Ελλάδα και στην Συρία, θα τους ρωτούσα. Τι φταίμε εμείς? Γιατί ο κόσμος είναι στραβός και άδικος? Στην οικογένεια φοβόμαστε μήπως τα πράγματα γίνουν χειρότερα και δεν έχουμε πού να πάμε.
Okay. This is not working. Okay. No. If you could spare me two more minutes, I would like to share with you a video showing the potential of digital storytelling for personal expression and emotional comprehension of technology and through technology. In this project, in addition to the technical skills they acquired, participants learned to express themselves about the violence they experienced to break through some of the self-inflicted isolation associated with trauma and thus increased self-confidence. The majority of participants found it to be a wholesome experience. It was part of a project of MAX, a social profit organization working in disadvantaged areas of Brussels. Please, the third video. Yes, this is. All the possible media.
Yeah. Oh my God, why did you kill my father? He's just an old man. He's innocent. He doesn't know anything. Please, I beg you in the name of God, leave him. Leave him. I beg. Mom, Skay, come. They're killing my dad. Please, I beg. Don't kill him. Don't kill him. Don't kill him.
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope that this presentation has illuminated the fact that the use of the narrative concept and storytelling laid out by Aristotle so many years ago and defined as a cohesive entirety comprising of beginning, middle, and end is our way of giving meaning to the data and thus enhancing every learning procedure. Digital narratives, apart from digital storing per se, can be put to use not only in the numerous paths of digital games, but also in the adaptive aspects of e-learning and of MOOCs, since the cloud is full of human stories. In the words of the world-famous Greek conductor and artistic director of Perm State Opera and Ballet Theater here in Russia, Theodor Kurengis, we should design a framework of educational provisions which, among others, aspires to trace and accentuate the wounded information that writhes inside us. This is, ladies and gentlemen, my story, full of determination to remain human through bits and bytes. Thank you.
Спасибо, профессор Майкл Меймарис. Thank you very much, профессор Меймарис. Следующий наш спикер будет Puntsag Tsagaan, съветник президента Монголии по въпросам политики по минералам, енергии, инфраструктури, развитие и перспективи монголски информационни технологии. Next, our speaker. Mr. Tsagaan is here? No, I think. Let's skip him. Господин професор Гард Тилстат, генералният секретар Международного съвета по откритому и дистанционному образование Норвегия. Почувствуйте разницы, глобальные тенденции в открытом, дистанционном и электронном обучении. Mr. Gard Tilstat, Secretary General, International Council for Open and Distant Education, Norway. Make a difference, global trends in open, distance and e-learning. You have a floor, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chair, I would like to share with you two challenges and three messages. To summarize now what I will take you through my presentation. So the first challenge, which we could call a really grand challenge, is that fact that we need to remove the barriers preventing large part of the world taking part in the knowledge revolution, in particular those countries south of Sahara. That is number one. The next is to go into that great needs for higher education, to let them, all them that aspire for that education, to take part in quality higher education the next 5-15 years to come. To meet with these two grand challenges, I have three messages. And observing the trends in the world, the first message would be to all the higher education institutions, in particular the senior management, to lead their institutions into opening up and put the faculty itself in lead of quality education. The second message would be to governments. For governments to create that favorable framework, which we all need in all parts of the world, to develop quality, open and distance education for all. And the third message I will address to all of you and many partners outside this building, that we need to partner up to meet with these challenges. So that is my message today, and I could quit now. But I will take you through a short raisonnement for this. First, a few words about ICDE, International Council for Open and Distance Education. We are a 75-year-old association created before UNESCO, partnered up with UNESCO already in the late 1960s, by pioneers, at that time, correspondence education, and nowadays, opening up education with all means. Either it's by pen and books or digital means. And among typical ICD members are here, if I could say, it's Hamdan bin Mohammed Smart University. It is like UNISA in South Africa. It is like Oslo University, Conventional University in Bergen, in Oslo, Norway. It is China Open University, and many, many more. I think we cover about 10% of the student population in the world, and also all regional associations, almost all regional associations for open distance online e-learning takes part in the collaboration in through ICDE in all parts of the world. We are also the proud publisher for a new scientific journal which is 100% open access. Introducing you more in depth to the grand challenge number one. This picture is from the last survey from OECD going back to 1870. How was life? And it is showing the level of education, how it has developed in West Europe, in the world, and in Africa south of Sahara. And as most of you know, education, 4 to 5 years of length, many years ago, was enough to have impact on the society, to develop the economy, to create the foundation for democracy. Not anymore. Today, it is 7, 8 years education at least that is necessary in a society for that development to take place. And higher education is the key because higher education delivers added value to the individual, to the state through income, to the society abroad, and to the economy. And I think the economist Pickett, he has suggested that the next best measure to share wealth is to educate people. However, this is our challenge, to breach that curve so that the whole world can take part in this development. That is not possible without open and distance education. And just to give you a few words on open and distance education, because it is a very broad concept, and there is no one model, there is no one university. There are very many different models that are in work in open and distance education, dual mode, online-only universities, conventional universities with partly flexible education, online education in the US, etc. So all the concepts that you will discuss here, from mobile learning to flipped classroom, will all take part within that umbrella of open and distance education. When attacking the grand challenges, one focus has to be on girls and women, since nowadays it's good evidence that that leads to a lot of benefits for the society in broad and for, of course, girls and women in particular. It saves lives of mothers and their children, improves child nutrition and health, reduces early marriage and pregnancies, increases job opportunities, it leads to faster growth, increases tolerance and understanding. It increases awareness and sensitization and about environmental issues. So that old African proverb, if you educate the man, you educate an individual, but if you educate the woman, you educate a nation, is still valid. Taking you to the next grand challenge. It is documented already that we have gone from elite education in higher education to mass education. And that development has not led to more alike education or harmonized education. No, it's just opposite, much more diverse than ever. However, what we have seen up to now in all regions of the world is nothing if we compare what is to come if we meet with the needs. So these numbers are based on EU and OECD projections that the need will increase for about 180 million enrollments today to up to 410 for the next 15 years to come. However, if you observed what happened with the MOOCs, these numbers might be too small. Why? Well, I would say that one thing is documented through the popularity of MOOCs, and that is that those people that has got education need more. They are addicted. They enjoy it throughout life. So that is the second challenge to meet with. Not possible without open and distance education. Try to do it with bricks and mortar or locally. Wouldn't work alone. While the US, North America, Europe was the historical hotspots of higher education, tomorrow's hotspots are Asia, it is Africa. And also Latin America and the Caribbean. So outstanding teaching has to happen here. So the real big challenge we are facing is opening up the road to knowledge for all that people. And what do you think about that? I think we have different images of that opening up, and several speakers have touched upon that. It could be like a dream, or opening up means more hard work, tougher, rougher, all the time. Or into the sky, or just another opening up. Or that the alternative is ignorance. Fair enough, MOOCs maybe is opening up. Maybe it is more about open education. Or open access, as the vision from UN, or just an open road. Or, as already told at this conference, Opening Up Education, illustrated in that book published already in 2008, and in Brazilian or Portuguese in 2014. Or maybe it's only about joy. Well, observing the drivers, seen from an ICD perspective, we have at least these five important drivers that are creating the conditions for opening up the road for knowledge. And when that is happening, we are not seeing one innovation or one disruption, but again and again, our institutions, our governments will be fronted with disruptions and innovations. And when I use the word disruption here, don't confuse it with disruptive learning, which is something totally different. We're talking about disruptions in technologies and in innovations. I will briefly touch about a few of those drivers, in particular the societal needs, the technology issue, which we know maybe most about and least about, and the open issue. First, what was launched as the big disruption? And this slide is shown before. It's based on Harvard and MIT data. But I think it is good to see it again. So either you choose to say, so what? Or you are happy with this or not happy with this. This is the preliminary situation described here. What will come, I don't know. But what is sure, this is not the answer on the two grand challenges. So here I leave the discussion about the MOOCs. However, findings from the US shows that it has been a big change in the thinking of senior management in higher education institutions. Why? Because nowadays, which is significant difference from before, they think that their everyday will be about innovations and disruptions. And this already was predicted and introduced by Imma Tubella, the previous rector at the Open University of Catalonia, already in 2011, turning universities upside down. And now, let me just orally speak about a concept that is well known in Europe and in the Nordic countries, namely the concept of the knowledge triangle, which briefly is about acknowledging the three basic functions of universities, which is education, research, and innovation. And that was established as a concept to better understand that the interaction between those was necessary for outstanding higher education, but also for innovation in the society and in business. However, I think that concept had two basic weaknesses. One, it does not recognize openness. It does not recognize open data, open science, open access, open innovation, open education resources. And second, it does not recognize the need to innovate from inside. The big picture regarding higher education is that open online distance education is steadily increasing all over the world. Here, The example is North America, which is the best documented by Jeff Seaman and Babson's survey through 10 years, steadily increasing through the years. And last year, it was the first year that online education increased faster than the enrollments in total. This picture is new and more dramatic. It is showing the increase in South America, in Brazil. Look at that. It's just amazing. It's showing the need in the society and how that is undertaken by open and distance education or blended learning more. And the breach you can see there is because at that time it was regulated. To look at that curve invites for huge discussion, which I will not take now. But most important is it shows the development, the trend, and the potential. So basically what is happening is that classical open and distance education and classical conventional is convergent into blended learning. Three streams in parallel, it's the technology, it's the methodologies, and it's new knowledge about the brain. And I think we have to observe all these at the same time. This is showing the trend from China, illustrated by the president of China Open University, where they are building a comprehensive infrastructure to undertake education on all levels in all parts of the country, and it might happen digital. This is the trend exemplified by Obama committing to open education resources a few weeks ago. This is an example from a small country, in this case my home country, Norway, where they established the MOOC Commission, giving a set of recommendations for how the small country with 5 million inhabitants can open up and use the MOOC concept, but interpreted into Norwegian. And the initiative from the European Commission showing that regions are on their move, opening up. Observing the open education resources and open access, there has been a very good development the last years. Now, most of senior researchers believe that open access will be the main publishing way for the future. Observing the need for higher education, I think that these two findings by OECD in the report about the state of higher education are crucial. First, it is again documented the added value by higher education. Secondly, higher education without a degree does not boost earnings. So until that is changed, this is our guidance. Technology, just in short, not on today's technology, but what we can observe is that through each new basic development of technology, it takes some time, and then the utilization, the use of technology, will increase 10 times. So this is why we see this extremely explosive use in the society through time. The way ahead, and I'm already by my messages, I hope I am still within time. And again, based on these observations, these trends, the message number one is for senior management to innovate from within the system, to open up, put the faculty in lead. It's a huge, huge task. So we need to support that, all of us. And we need the support, second, from the government to create a favorable framework. What does that mean? I will not go in detail, but it is a long list. And for example, in Europe, while everyone is talking about open access, show me one country that has incentives for educators to publish in open access. And I will put it in my next slide. So that is an example of what have to happen. Think about the economical framework for higher education. Couldn't we just move where you are taking the pricing? It costs anyway. It is not for free. Will never be for free. The question is, where do you price it? We can price it so you open up, or you can price it so you close it down for the elite. This is up to governments. And stakeholders should team up. A last example, which is addressed for us, all of us here, and my colleagues in the board, the governing board for UNESCO IITE, which is a so exciting task. And that is, this very good publication from UNESCO was published a short time ago about the collaboration between the BRICS country and education. And coming to recommendation number 4, manage the rapid expansion of higher education. Yes, I found something, a few words, about open and distance education. And what could I read? Yeah. The recommendation is that the governments in the BRICS should look at how to understand the potential benefits and risks of new technologies. Great, but this is history. It's already happening. So I think they should look at it again, and maybe those governments could establish incentives for excellent knowledge networks to develop open and distance education, to learn from each other, to create quality education for all. ICD works together with UNESCO to create a policy dialogue globally and regionally on these issues, hopefully leading to some recommendations or reports that can be useful for governments and education system. Спасибо.
Спасибо, профессор Тилстада. Очень интересное представление. Thank you, Professor Tilstad. Very interesting presentation. Personally, I have a question, but later on in the break, coffee break, I shall ask you something about the Catalonia Open University. Позвольте мне дать предоставить слово Юрию Рубин, профессор Рубин, ректор Московского финансово-промышленного университета Синергия Российской Федерации. Его представление, вопросы и качество образования в процессе имплементации и лернинга. I give the floor to Professor Rubin, Rector of Moscow University for Industry and Finance Synergy, Assurance of Education Quality and Process of Implementation of e-Learning. You have the floor, Professor, please.
Well, thank you very much. Supposedly, I'm the only Russian speaker within this plenary meeting. So if you forgive me, and let me speak Russian language and show you my presentation. Unfortunately, it's in Russian. Of course, I don't see it, unfortunately, now. Я хотел бы, да, чтобы ее как-то все-таки включили, мою презентацию по возможности, чтобы я мог начать ей руководить. Нет? Левый? Левый? Окей. Нету? Ну, давайте я вам ее дам, а вы ее поставите. Сможете это сделать? Sorry.
Presentation is not written yet, but now will be done.
Уважаемые коллеги, я надеюсь, что там перевод будет работать. Да? И пока уважаемые организаторы готовят презентацию, я позволю пару слов сказать. Во-первых, спасибо большое за это замечательное мероприятие. Очень интересная конференция, очень представительная. И я благодарен организаторам за то, что мне предоставлено слово. Я являюсь не только ректором одного из ведущих в России университетов, которые работают в сфере имплементации инструментов e-learning, но также в течение нескольких лет хожу в руководящий совет Европейского фонда обеспечения качества образования в e-learning. И я хотел бы начать с того, о чем здесь говорил мой уважаемый коллега и друг, профессор Кристиан Штраке. Он говорил о качестве, он говорил о том, что качество – это очень важно, и что качество – это то, что очень трудно определить. Я не могу не согласиться с этим, ибо вся история образования сопровождается дискуссиями о том, что такое качество. Но я хотел бы сказать, что для тех, кто реально занимается организацией образовательной деятельности, ответы на этот вопрос есть. Они все прекрасно знают, что качество образования – это великая социальная ценность, это конкурентное преимущество университета или колледжа, и самое главное, что это важнейший ориентир упорядочения образовательных систем. Вот об этом упорядочении я хотел бы и поговорить сегодня, опираясь на некоторые кейсы, которые сегодня разворачиваются в Российской Федерации именно в сфере упорядочивания образовательных систем, в части оценки качества как инструмента этого упорядочения, о том, каким образом e-learning может здесь быть полезен как инструмент и как объект оценивания и объект упорядочения. Сегодня общим мировым трендом является то, что в большом перечне интересантов сферы образования, заинтересованных сторон, мы находим разных интересантов, каждый из которых имеет свой интерес в сфере образования и имеет свой интерес в сфере применения e-learning в образовании. Это и рынок труда, профессиональное сообщество, работодатели, студенты, студенческие организации, это академическое сообщество, это сами образовательные организации, это специализированные организации, которые работают в сфере экспертизы качества образования. Российское законодательство дает обширные возможности для формирования различных оценок. И новая редакция закона, которая действует в России уже в течение года, она позволяет сегодня использовать разные подходы, разные возможности. Надо сказать о том, что такая внешняя оценка качества, она очень полезна для разных целей. Вот, и очень полезна для самих образовательных организаций, которые, собственно, претендуют на определенные позиции, на то, чтобы быть определены в качестве носителей, обладателей особых конкурентных преимуществ. Очень верно в своем докладе нам показал Кристиан Штраке о том, что качество образования следует рассматривать с трех позиции, а именно с позиции качества результатов обучения, качества применяемых ресурсов и качества процессов. При этом, скажем, индикаторы качества могут иметь результирующий, ресурсный, процессуальный характер при определяющей роли качества результатов обучения. Сопоставление результатов обучения с образовательными ресурсами дает представление об эффективности образования. В течение последних лет целый ряд уважаемых организаций, международных организаций действуют в сфере формирования образовательных ресурсов, в сфере обучения, образования ресурсов и learning в сфере обучения, становление эффективных процессов обучения с помощью инструментов и learning, И также в сфере, собственно, формирования подходов к оценке качества результатов обучения, оценке качества ресурсов и оценке качества процессов, которые осуществляются с помощью e-learning. В числе таких организаций есть Европейский фонд обеспечения качества образования с использованием e-learning, European Foundation for Quality in e-learning, который, собственно, в течение всего периода своего существования, 10 лет, формировал целый ряд очень полезных, интересных проектов, которые сегодня позволяют нам здесь, в России, собственно, активно применять инновации и активно развивать новую ресурсную базу, активно развивать новые процессы в сфере обучения и помогают нам сформировать подходы в сфере оценки качества образования, которые сегодня все более и более востребованы российскими университетами. Я буквально в нескольких словах вам расскажу о ряде таких проектов. Скажем, проект «Консит», который посвящен вопросам создания контента в открытом образовательном ресурсе с участием самих пользователей. Этот проект получил широкое распространение в нашей стране и используется целым рядом российских университетов. Проект «Опал». Сегодня мы видели небольшую информацию о проекте «Опал» в выступлении моих коллег. «Опал» — это проект, целью которого является поддержка открытых образовательных практик, что приводит к повышению эффективности преподавания, обучения путем увеличения числа улучшения открытых образовательных ресурсов, которые могут быть включены в программы высшего образования. Программа «Опал», проект «Опал», кстати говоря, это проект, который был завершен несколько лет назад и который завершился не только, собственно, декларациями поддержки, но и инструментарием поддержки, а также инструментарием оценки этих образовательных ресурсов. А проект «СИВАК», собственно, явился первым проектом, который представлял собой инструмент, созданный с помощью информационных технологий для проведения самооценки качества e-learning в сфере высшего образования. И, наконец, наиболее значительным явлением в перечне достижений, перечне проектов, стал проект «ЮНИК», в рамках которого, начиная с 2009 года, целый ряд европейских университетов прошел сертификацию, институциональную сертификацию, и начиная с 2010 года проект этот, который дал нам, собственно, продукт, позволяющий оценивать деятельность университетов по развитию электронного обучения, проект стал постепенно становиться все более и более популярным в Российской Федерации. Данный продукт предполагает сертификацию деятельности образовательных учреждений, университетов в сфере образовательного контента, в сфере образовательных ресурсов, в сфере образовательных процессов. Это на сегодняшний день наиболее полный, наиболее внятный продукт, который активно используется в России, и к нему сегодня привержен целый ряд университетов, к опыту которых впоследствии мы обратимся. Я хотел бы сказать о том, о чем мне сказал Кристиан Штраке. Он очень скромно вам рассказал о деятельности комитета, который он возглавляет в ISO, Международной организации по стандартизации, которая явила миру первый в истории мирового образования стандарт в области применения информационно-коммуникационных технологий в образовании. Это, с моей точки зрения, выдающаяся работа, и результаты этой работы на сегодняшний день являются платформой, благодаря которой возможно появление разных подходов, разных продуктов, разных программ, которые могут применяться в сфере институциональной и программной оценки, в оценке того, каким образом, насколько эффективно и успешно применяется e-learning в образовании. 10 лет этому, собственно, стандарту, И, наверное, в следующем году надо будет торжественно отметить это явление. Мне очень приятно, что когда-то, 10 лет назад, на конференции в Берлине Кристиан, тогда еще молодой исследователь, докладывал об этом на секции, которую я руководил. Мне очень приятно об этом вспоминать каждый раз. Но сегодня я вхожу в состав этого, российской части этой комиссии. Здесь существует целая группа заинтересованных лиц, которые активным образом участвуют в дальнейшей разработке стандартных подходов в сфере e-learning, в сфере применения КТ в образовании. Так вот, ЮНИК явился, наверное, одним из таких очень важных продуктов, которые полностью сориентированы на, собственно, стандарт, который был разработан в рамках ISO, и который сегодня, наверное, в нашей стране, в Российской Федерации, является наиболее востребованным со стороны целого ряда университетов. И, наконец, продукт, который называется ECB-чек, который в большей мере применим в сфере оценки качества образования на программном уровне, который сегодня может быть имплементирован в традиционные схемы оценивания качества образования на программном уровне. В настоящее время в этот продукт включает в себя ряд критериев, по которым производится оценка, а именно это информация о программе организации обучения, ориентации на целевую группу, качество контента, дидактический дизайн, медиадизайн, технология, оборудование, инфраструктура, пакеты прикладных программ, оценка качества, инструменты оценки качества полученных компетенций и знаний с студентами и внутренний аудит, который организован образовательной организацией. Практически сегодня деятельность в области оценивания качества подошла на платформе, которая заложена была в стандартах ISO, подошла вплотную к ключевому вопросу, а именно к вопросу оценки качества результатов обучения на основании компетентностного подхода, в котором можно было бы отразить уровень эффективности имплементации learning в образовательные программы. Есть традиционные модели оценки качества результатов обучения, которые сегодня в России все более и более получают широкое распространение. Где же здесь e-learning? E-learning сегодня входит в традиционные российские схемы экспертной деятельности, в том разделе программ экспертизы, которые посвящены аудиту условий реализации образовательных программ и обеспечения гарантии качества образования. Интересно отметить, что опыт России в данном процессе был активно использован в международном проекте, в котором участвовали, в частности, Европейская ассоциация по гарантиям качества образования ENQA, European Association for Quality Assurance in Higher Education, совместно с упомянутым мной в QL и Европейской ассоциацией университетов дистанционного обучения. Проект Sequent, который сегодня завершается, который активно обсуждается в общественностью и европейской, и российской, в рамках которого, собственно, были даны оценки того, насколько продукт под названием ЮНИК, продукт под названием CB-Check и продукт Европейской ассоциации Excellence, насколько эти продукты могут быть включены в деятельность традиционных европейских аккредитационных агентств, тех организаций, которые в нормативном порядке производят процедуры аккредитации образовательных программ в странах Европейского Союза. Но для России, которая не входит в Европейский Союз, как вы знаете, важно также определение степени причастности материалов, инструментов, которые позволяли бы оценивать эффективность и качество имплементации learning для оценки образовательных программ, которые в России становятся очень важными. Скажем, в России, для России сегодня очень важной является процедура международной аккредитации образовательных программ. И вот тот путь, которым я вам сегодня рассказываю, как раз является одним из наиболее востребованных в современной российской практике. А за прошедший период целый ряд очень таких важных учебных заведений российских либо уже прошли такие процедуры сертификации, аккредитации, либо в настоящее время, значит, находятся в процессе. И важно отметить, что в последние годы наибольший интерес проявляют вузы, которые относятся к категории так называемых ведущих вузов, федеральные и национальные исследовательские университеты. В настоящее время, слово сказать, процедуры такой аккредитации в России, в них участвует целый ряд федеральных университетов, а именно Уральский федеральный, Северо-Восточный федеральный, Сибирский федеральный, Приволжский федеральный университет. Целый ряд вузов, которые называются у нас национальными исследовательскими, которые стараются также эффективно использовать инструменты e-learning в деятельности по повышению качества образования. Вот на этом позвольте завершить мое выступление, еще раз поблагодарив организаторов за возможность обменяться мнениями с коллегами и за возможность принять участие в этой замечательной конференции. Спасибо.
Большое спасибо, профессор Рубин, за интересное представление. Thank you very much, Professor Rubin, for interesting presentation. Сейчас я же буду дам слово Кузвиница Питер Дзимбу, исполнительный декан педагогического колледжа Университета Южной Африки. Он же говорит на тему «Доступ, равенство и качество, ограничения и возможности электронного обучения в Африканском университете». Now I shall give the floor to Mr. Dzimbu, Executive Dean, College of Education, University of South Africa, UNISA, Republic of South Africa, Access, Quality and Equity, Limits and Possibilities of E-Learning in the African University. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Let me also join others to thank the director of IITE for inviting me and my colleagues, and in particular for inviting me to be part of the board. I'm looking forward to the 5-year tenure with my colleagues on this board. I think our first meeting is tomorrow morning. So thank you very much for the invitation. This is my first time to Moscow and to Russia, so this is a very special occasion for me. Thank you. What I'm going to talk about, I think most of you have talked about it, but I'm going to talk about it from a very small perspective, and that perspective is the African perspective. The first thing I just want to highlight is that in terms of higher education in sub-Saharan Africa, in terms of the provision of higher education, the trajectory is obviously a focus on access, followed by issues of equity. And obviously, like everybody else was talking about, issues of quality in terms of the provision of higher education. And the hope is that leads to economies of scale so that at least we can pass on the savings to students and in the process be able to provide quality education. But in the final analysis, the movement is towards blended and online teaching and learning. There are very few universities on the African continent that have taken this form of a trajectory for reasons that I will be able to explain in this presentation. The major challenges that face us on the African continent as far as higher education is concerned are not very different from what's common here. The first one is obviously the unequal access to ICTs and lack of a very robust, cost-effective, and scalable bandwidth. Unlike the situation in Europe, in North America and Brazil to some extent, we do not own the bandwidth that's coming to the African continent. We buy it at a very high cost. So that's the first challenge we face in terms of provision of higher education and e-learning in particular. Then the next issue that I'll talk about is digital literacies in terms of the capacity of students and staff to take advantage of affordances brought about by ICTs and e-learning and Web 2.0 technologies. A number of you are talking of Web 3.0 technologies. We are still at a completely different stage. Then I'll also talk about pedagogical practices. For us on the African continent, and I think for some of you, this is quite critical. Unless we talk about pedagogy, I think it becomes very difficult to talk about change or to talk about reform within the higher education sector. Then I'll talk very briefly about independent learning and the autonomy of the learner in particular, and issues of metacognition and bridging what Moore and others refer to as transactional distance in online teaching and learning, especially when you talk about structure and we talk about the independence of the learner and when you talk about dialogue as well. And then finally, I'll talk about the slow pace in the development of mobile learning, open education resources, and MOOCs on the African continent. I'll just do that very briefly because the answer of why we are not yet there is quite obvious. When we talk about unequal access to ICT on the continent, the first issue that we talk about is the macroeconomic and political difficulties across the continent. For us, and as I listen to most of you talk, I don't hear the link between education and the economy from the perspective that affects us on the African continent. For us, the economy, the political system, have got a very serious negative or positive impact on higher education and on the provision of higher education in particular, depending in what country you are. For most of our countries, the urban and rural divide is still very critical. The urban and rural divide in a number of countries is so serious to the extent that, as I'll talk, the participation rates in higher education are very, very small. They range from 4% in a country such as Niger to about 22% in South Africa. If you compare that with countries with similar GDPs that are in the 70s and in the 80s, most of the African continent, in terms of the urban and rural divide, it affects the participation rates in higher education in a very negative manner. Then the other thing that, as I've said, that contributes to the unequal access to higher education and the unequal access to the role of ICTs in higher education is obviously the cost of bandwidth and connectivity. The rest of the African continent is covered, every square inch is covered by a satellite. The rest of the African continent is covered by marine sea cables. I could have put the map on for you, but it is the price of that bandwidth that at the end of the day is critical in terms of making it possible for us either to access ICTs or to access higher education. Then the development of educational research networks is an initiative in almost every African country, so that institutions of higher learning in particular can then broker bandwidth so that they can increase accessibility to bandwidth and connectivity. So that's, for me, the main issues that affect access to ICTs on the African continent. And as such, hence the unequal nature of the provision of tertiary education on the continent. One of the things that is of importance to us is obviously digital literacy. And I heard people talk about the digital natives and obviously the digital immigrants. But for us, that's a critical issue. The University of South Africa is obviously the largest distance education university in Africa with close to 430,000 students. And we did do a study. About 80% of those students have got access either to a cell phone. They've also got access either to a laptop or a tablet. And some of them obviously have got access to computers. But again, the same challenge that I've talked about of bandwidth and connectivity, and the cost of that bandwidth is still remains an issue. And the challenge is digital literacy for both the students and the academics in our institutions of higher learning. As such, the notion for capacity development or continuing professional development for both students and academics in terms of digital literacy becomes a major activity in the African Academy to bring about a new thinking regarding online teaching, learning, and learner support. So digital literacy for us is critical. Digital literacy for us becomes a very important component of our transition, either to a blended mode of teaching and learning or to online teaching and learning. One of the issues that is very close to my heart is the old notion of the adoption of the semantic web and the affordances that it brings about. Those affordances are obviously the capacity of information storage and retrieval. I don't think for us on the African continent this is now a problem at all, because we've even begun to migrate towards cloud computing. So as far as that is concerned, we are probably where every other nation is. Then the capacity for non-human agents, and I think this is where most of our challenges still are in terms of the migration to a maximum usage of ICTs for teaching, for learning, and even for research. And then the third affordance is obviously that of capacity of the internet to support learning. As I've said, in some instances, because of issues that are concerned or that are connected to bandwidth and connectivity, in some of our institutions and in some of our countries, that is still a problem. But the issue of the affordances, these three affordances, for me, it's an interesting research topic that I continue to pursue in terms of understanding the challenges that most African countries are facing as far as bandwidth and connectivity and its impact on teaching and learning and research as well. The issue of quality, in my view, is affected and impacted upon by the pedagogical practices that we bring into the fore. For me, quality and innovation and blended learning are part and parcel of the same side of the coin in terms of pedagogy and the types of pedagogies that we put in place. So in dealing with this issue, the first challenge is obviously enhancing learner autonomy and self-directed learning. I think a lot of people today and yesterday did talk about the importance of learner autonomy and self-directed learning as far as the introduction and the role and obviously the advantages of ICTs in teaching and learning. For us, in terms of the teaching and learning philosophy, like was said earlier on by others, is that obviously we believe that students and academics, we believe that students among themselves are able to create their own reality, are able to create their own meanings. And this is where we start from in terms of developing pedagogies that we use in either online, pure online teaching and learning, or blended modes of teaching and learning. And you obviously all know that that comes from Vygotsky and others. We also are very keen in terms of the development of learning architectures that emphasize learning in which dialogue and continuous feedback are essential to the teaching and learning processes. I was very happy when I saw one of the colleagues talk about the work of Paulo Freire and others in terms of dialogue. For us in the developing world, for us on the African continent, this way of looking at teaching and learning and this way of looking at pedagogical practices, you know, becomes central to reforms that we make in education, in higher education in particular. I saw the questions that were being asked by one of our colleagues in terms of what is educational change, what is educational reform, and for us, the most important issues are concerned with the transformation of teaching and the transformation of learning and the transformation, obviously, of how we assess our students so that we are able to understand issues of access, we're able to understand issues of success and quality at the same time. The key elements of this model are very simple. The very simple elements of the model that we are talking about. Dialogue and feedback are essential between the learner and the academic as a facilitator of educational experiences. Without that dialogue, learning does not take place. Without that dialogue, very little learning takes place. Within this element, we also feel that there has to be a relationship, almost a dialectical relationship between the learner and content. Because without that relationship between the learner and content, it means the learner is not able to mediate content for himself or for herself. Within this model, we also feel that it is important that there are relationships between the learner and her peers, or the learner and his peer, and his peers. Because learning in this kind of an environment becomes a social activity. For us, because of the inequalities I talked about earlier on, the relationship between the learner and the context is critical as we develop our curriculum. It is critical as we implement our curriculum, and it is critical as we evaluate our curriculum. Because the context of the learner is very important. And number five, we also feel that it is important when we talk about this model that there's a need for the learner to interact with technology in such a manner that the technology does not drive the learner, but the technology becomes a tool that the learner uses, and both the academic also uses in the teaching and learning process. Just to continue the model, when we look at such a model, we are very interested in the way it engenders new forms of knowledge. This is a theme that, as I listened, maybe I probably missed it, but this is a theme for us which is very important on the African continent. Because for a number of years, we have been at the receiving end where we consumed what we did not produce and produced what we did not consume. So right now, the focus is on the production of knowledge that we consume and on the production of knowledge that we also send both to the north, to the east, and to the west. So the issues are problematic knowledge and knowledge integration, higher order thinking and depth of knowledge. Yesterday, somebody was talking about deep knowledge. For us, the concerns are obviously an emphasis on high order thinking and depth of knowledge for both the student and the teacher. Then depth of students' understanding and substantive conversations. Obviously, the issue of dialogue is not dialogue for its own sake. It is dialogue for understanding, and it is dialogue for meaning, and it is dialogue for conversations that results in the development of knowledge. Then obviously, the use of a meta-language and academic engagement. As I walk around, I am impressed by the fact that everybody speaks in Russian. You do your physics and your engineering in Russian. But for most of us on the continent, it's either it's French, or it's Portuguese, or it's English. As I speak to you in English, I think in my own language. And that process brings a lot of cognitive dissonance. And that's why we feel very uncomfortable to speak in English. But so the use of language becomes critical in terms of academic engagement in online teaching or in blended teaching and learning. The model obviously engenders new forms of knowledge. We are quite interested in looking at ICTs critically. While we agree that ICTs are critical in teaching and learning, we are always extremely skeptical because we do not own the technology. And therefore, we are concerned with issues of cultural and indigenous knowledge systems as they are either bracketed out or embedded in what we do within the academy. We are also interested in issues of valuing differences which are based either on race, on gender, even on sexual orientation, and on class. Because I think somebody said it yesterday, that ICTs are not a silver bullet. And for us on the African continent, ICTs at times actually engender inequalities, which, as we all know, are popularly known as the digital divide. because of issues that I've raised earlier on. We are also very interested in terms of new forms of knowledge that we have to develop group identities in learning communities of our students, in learning communities of students and their peers, in learning communities of our students and their context, and in learning communities of our students and obviously their academics who teach them. For us then, obviously, we'd hope that that would lead to student self-regulation as they approach different forms of knowledge and different forms of education within the higher education sector. The issue of ICTs, as far as we are concerned, on the African continent and in sub-Saharan Africa in particular, we are concerned with issues of transactional distance and structure in terms of how students access knowledge. So if you were to come to our institutions, for instance, the notion of epistemological access, the notion of access by students to knowledge becomes critical. When we talk about the merits and demerits of ICTs, one of the issues that is always paramount in our minds is how do students access knowledge? And how far does ICT or ICTs make it easier for students to be nearer knowledge or to access knowledge? For us, those issues are quite important in terms of determining how we take the role of ICTs in education and learning. According to Moore, a common cause of failure, or at least causes failing short of expectations, is the failure to design the balance of structure and dialogue that is appropriate for a particular student population. So on the African continent, when we talk about the introduction of ICTs in our higher education institutions, the issue of the organizational architecture, or the issue of an institutional architecture that engenders the use of ICTs becomes important, in particular because of the issue of transactional distance. In other words, the distance that the learner or the student finds himself or herself in relation to contact, in relation to content that comes through ICTs. The questions that are critical in minimizing transactional distance are as follows. Is learning self-initiated and self-motivated by the learner, by the curriculum, by the context, or even by the content? Who identifies goals and objectives and selects problems for study? This, for us, is a key question, and I would hazard and say it is probably an ideological question before it becomes both a philosophical and an epistemological question. Because the question of who owns that knowledge is critical for us. As I watch presentations that talk about different forms of content that are coming either from Europe, from North America, the question that is paramount in my mind is who owns that knowledge? Who originates that knowledge? And some of you probably say, we all own the knowledge. I wish if we had time to discuss that. Who determines the pace, and who determines the sequence, and who determines the methods of information gathering that eventually passes out and comes through as knowledge either via the internet or via the web, or even through open source? And for us, these are critical questions in terms of minimizing transactional distance, because our main concern is the notion of who owns the knowledge and obviously the access of students and the academics to that knowledge that comes through the use of ICTs and obviously Web 2.0, and some of you are talking Web 3.0. Is emphasis on gathering information external to the learner? Nowadays, a lot of people say the issue is no longer content because content is out there. But the question we ask from both a philosophical and I would hazard to say an epistemological position is that is emphasis on gathering information external to the learner? Because that's a key question for us. And secondly, how flexible is each instructional process to the requirement of the learner? So when we talk the role of ICTs in teaching and learning in higher education for our purposes, the question of instructional models that we use becomes critical. But obviously, for most of you in this room, we all know when you look at an instructional model, whether it passes through ICTs or not, is not ahistorical, is not apolitical, and it is not neutral. And for us, those are key questions that we need to answer. The third question is, how useful and what are the issues of quality of learning and how they're going to be judged? So the issue of quality is very relative. The issue of quality is closely related to the issue of context. And the issue of quality is closely related to the issue of utility. The issue of quality for us is obviously also closely related to the notion of graduateness, the student that comes out of the institution. The fourth question is, what provision is there for the development of learners' ideas and for creative solutions to problems? I think a lot of people today and yesterday talked a lot about innovation and creativity that is brought about by the use of ICTs within higher education. For us, the key question is, what is the role of the learner, what is the role of the student in terms of that creativity? I found the presentation by the professor from Greece very fascinating, because knowledge came from an elderly woman and knowledge came from a very small boy, probably five, six years old. That's the kind of issue that we are talking about when we talk about critical issues in terms of minimizing transactional distance within the higher education sector. And here is the structure of transactional distance, which is very close to my heart. I will put that's the complete diagram. If you look on this, on the axis, this side, what we are saying is that as transactional distance increases, then dialogue is less. When dialogue is less, then the role of education is no longer transformative. When the transactional distance is reduced, then there's more dialogue. When there's more dialogue, then it means there is more learning that takes place. And it is within that space that the issues of creativity can be found. It is within that space where there's more dialogue that we feel that then the student, together with the teacher, together with her peers, have got access to knowledge. The whole issue of epistemological access for us is critical, because in the end, the person who owns the knowledge is the person who has got the power. And the person who owns the knowledge is the person that is able to control the future. And I think at a supranational level, these are the key issues that we grapple with today. If you look at the whole essence, I think in Latin they say the fons et origo of the BRICS countries, you know, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Apart from the issue of capital, it is the issue of knowledge, who controls that knowledge from where we come from and from where we sit. So this is important in the teaching and learning situation. So if you look at the vertical axis, where we have got less and more, it's also related to where dialogue takes place. And those of you that are familiar with the work of Paulo Freire, I think it lends itself very easily to this kind of a discussion. I would like to, Mr. Chairman, to end my talk. The adoption of MOOCs and open education resources. The African continent, and sub-Saharan Africa in particular, there are efforts to go into open education resources. I used to be rector of the African Virtual University in Nairobi, Kenya, which pioneered the development of open education resources, I think around 2002 and 2003, for teacher education and for computer science. That project has now been scaled up to include close to 22 countries on the African continent. And currently the project is now owned by the South African Institute of Distance Education, which is located in Johannesburg in South Africa. So there are efforts both in Lusophone Africa, in Francophone Africa, and in North Africa in the production of open education resources. But when it comes to MOOCs, what makes it almost impossible in the African Academy to go the route of MOOCs is the whole notion of how we look at intellectual property and the financial mechanisms that academics do get in terms of their own proprietary intellectual property. And this is where the resistance is beginning, is coming from in terms of the adoption or in terms of the development of MOOCs. But in my former institution, UNISA, or the University of South Africa, what has happened at the moment is that we developed courses, for instance, in teacher education, we developed a course called On Being a Professional Teacher. And we called this course a signature module because every teacher of the 82,000 students that we're training had to take that course. But we have now begun to develop that course as a MOOC. We have now begun to develop that course so that it can go out there. The incentive for me as the dean of that college and the incentive for the entire college was very simple. The moment we put that course out there, it meant that we're very proud that that course was, in terms of its quality, could compare favorably with courses from other institutions. So that's the slow journey for most of us on the African continent in sub-Saharan Africa in terms of the development of MOOCs. But in terms of open educational resources, there is a very, very strong movement that is moving forward in terms of developing open education resources. And as I've said earlier on, the largest projects on the continent are OER Africa, and it cuts right across all the disciplines in medicine, in the physical sciences, in the human and social sciences, in engineering, in agriculture, etc. And that obviously is funded by multilateral and bilateral organizations. And as I said earlier on, the African Virtual University located in Nairobi, Kenya, is also very big. You can check their website. It's very big in terms of developing open education resources. But in terms of MOOCs, I think we are still right at the beginning of that development as institutions in sub-Saharan Africa. Thank you very much.
Just in time. Спасибо большое, профессор Дзымбу. Он дал нас некоторые новые возможности разобраться в возможности университетского образования в Южной Африке. Thank you very much, Professor Dzembu. He gave to us some new issues to understand the problems of university education in South Africa. The last our speaker will be Mr. Jukian Chen, which is, let's see, Jukian Chen is a chairman, China Yutong Science and Technology Group. His speech will be exploring educational informatization. You have the floor, sir.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's our great honor to have presentation here. Now we are discussing the exploring informationalization of educational technology equipment.
So we first discuss about Yalon, and the second is new demand for talents due to economic transition and industrial enterprise upgrading and doing learning teaching system, and the service provided by Yalon and exploring mutual cooperation. So Yalon was founded in 1983, and we have a history of 31 years. Now we have more than 1,000 staffs and have more than 200 engineers. Now, this is Zhejiang province to avoid the for us. This is our promise.
这是国务院副总理对我们公司很重视。这是这个吧？这就你讲吗？Now
it's our development strategy.
对我们发展的定位。Our
this technology-driven internet thinking and service-oriented manufacturing industry chain integration and international strategy.
我们亚龙开发是根据我们的经济发展和产业转型的情况的一些新需求。Now
we are developing it according to the new demand of the talent to the economic transition and industry enterprise upgrading. The demand of the economic developing. Now the industrial robots and the CNC maintenance, intelligent building, and the elevator, intelligent building, air conditioning, and the car. Automobiles.
还有我们那个电动汽车,
electronic automobiles.
包括轨道交通,
and the railway.
中国现在是, 成为世界上最长的轨道交通国家.
Now China has been the one of the important.
包括还有那个新能源,
now the new energy.
包括智能电网,
the smart grid. And the internet, data and cloud,
云计算,
cloud calculator,
3D
3D printing.
那么对我们整个现代制造业和现代服务业产生了很大的变化.
So this has a long effect to our modern manufacturing.
那么对企业对人才需求的要求.
Now we have a great demand for the talents.
包括现代产业的崛起、产业集群的崛起、产业链的拉长、上下游的拓展.
Now we have a great, we pay great importance to the industry.
这第二、第三点就是我们提出助学教育一体化，是培养技术和技能型人才的有效手段.
This is our philosophy. Doing learning and teaching integration is the effective means to train the skilled persons.
那么我们教育也面临着很多困惑.
Our education facing many questions.
那么有很多岗位找不到人，企业需求，教育有没有培养？
We need many talents.
那么我们首先在教育当中，先有工作，后有再有目标。
First,
先有目标，再有工作。
We first have job or we first have goals.
那么我们就是要把目标要定准，怎么做？
We must focus on the on the goal.
就是我们学生从入住校以后，他未来出来到底掌握什么样的技术，让他知道。虽然说我们提出了这个住校教育体化课程、过程评价这三个方面。
Yes, the
doing learning teaching integration. The first is the curriculum, the second is the process, three is the elevation, how to do, what to do.
课程是做什么, 过程是怎么做, 评价是做得怎么样?
What to do and what to learn and what to teach.
那么我认为助是学会教的基础,
doing is the base of the learning and teaching. Doing is the direction of learning and teaching.
那么我们举个例子,
this is file 3 through B, automation, production, line, training. If you learn the skill of this trainer, you may get the $3,000 for 1 month.
这个这套技术掌握,
this is a flexible manufacturing system. A robot process assemble.
那么我们的学生出来能不能掌握这些技术是很大的问题。
Yes, now the problem is the students whether can learn the skill of the trainer.
那么我亚龙现在为开发,
now Yalong has developed many excellent products and services.
包括自动化,
automation, electromechanics, industrial robots.
那么主要我们举个例子, 自动化, 里面的核心技术,
now the core value of the automation is this.
行业,
these are all the different industries like automobiles and food, mental, IT, electronics, and so on.
掌握关键的技术。那么举个例子，这些技术就是为自动化专业服务的。
These skills are service for automation.
那么这个是机器人技术。
This is a robot technology. These are the application areas.
那么这个是数控技术.
This is CNC technologies.
它的行业包括它的岗位,
these are the employment and the skills.
数控里面的核心技术.
The core skills of the CNC.
这个是电梯,
elevator maintenance and repair.
包括电梯里面的维修技术.
Many maintenance skills of repairing the elevators.
啊, 这是副中央空调.
Central air conditioning chiller.
嗯, 这是智能物联网,
intelligent building technology.
智能楼宇.
These are all the intelligent building.
所有各种智能楼宇, 它的 消防, 安防, 监控, 智能家具,
safety guard or
这是电子技术,
the electronic technologies,
单片机技术,
this
单片机,
智能, intelligent warehouse,
这是电器安装,
electrical installations,
这个是电器控制技术,
electrical control technologies,
这是电器安装,
electrical
电器装配和检测, 它的工艺,
it's a motors assemble and operation inspection.
产品质量做得好不好, 在这套设备上练。 这个是ER,
this is automobiles.
这是轨道交通,
railway control system.
就是我们把380的动车,
these are all the
380,
CHR380 high speed railway. We combine the technology of these to develop the trainer.
里面的所有核心技术我们都把它做出来。 这道是地铁,
this is subway.
整里面包括所有机车里面的电气控制, 自动化控制, 牵引系统, 刹车系统都有。
Yes, we simulate many systems of the subway.
这是高速铁路的供电系统。
This is the railway operation and maintenance.
这是那个地铁的供配电系统。
Subway power supply system.
这是新能源。
Solar electrical mechanical systems.
太阳能，这个就是通过这样的助学教育体系。
Now through the integration of doing learning and teaching, we now learn the skills of the systems.
那么我们的目标培养。
Now our goals.
他学生毕业了以后，整个活动设计，他能够完成关键能力吗？
Our goals is to train the students after graduation.
这就是第四个,
so the service provided by Yalong. So we do many service, teach, teaching material developing and cooperate with schools and so on. Now we develop many teaching materials.
Your
automation, industrial robots, CNC, railway, and so on.
等等.
The curriculum development, software.
这都是课程开发的软件.
Yes, this software we develop. POC training system, electronic systems, central air systems, and CNC systems.
这个是我们上面有很多慕课,
these are our online platform, online learning platform.
This
combined with our system to teach in the colleges
资源库,
and the resource constructions. Teaching material development, teacher training. This is the teachers training in Yalong. Training based constructions. So the training base designed by Yalong, and Yalong serves for skill competition. This is national competition. Yes, we held in China early. Yes. Yes, these are the sense of the skill competition, the certifications. Yes, cooperate with the schools. Help the school to support construction some items. Provide the training projects. Material writing and so on.
这个学校的电子教材, 仿真软件, 指导书, 后面这个红的读一下。
Oh. So we provide electronic teaching materials, simulation software, manual guide, and online learning systems.
还有MOOC等等。
And the MOOCs. Yalong has been to ASEAN countries since 2002. The report, yes, Indonesia. Cooperation with Yalong skills. Now this year we held two competition which held by Yalong. One is industrial automation, second is CNC maintenance, which held in Hanoi. Yes, ten countries from ASEAN countries will participate in this competition.
If you
have interesting, you can come to Hanoi to visit. This industrial automation system. The CNC installation and the commissioning system. The fault shooting and electronics can be shown in this machine. This is the skill competition sense in 2012 in Indonesia. And many worldwide teachers come to Yalong for training. The ASEAN delegations from Singapore, Indonesia, Philippines, and so on. Laos. Now, this is CNC expert training. This expert from Singapore. Yes. Now Yalong has cooperated with China ASEAN Association. This is a partner workshop. Visit colleges in ASEAN countries, Laos,
Vietnam.
Visit Cambodia. The Indonesia province come to Yalong for. Yalong will build strategic alliance with the supported schools. Our aim is to establish teacher training, curriculum development, and provide total solution to doing learning and teaching.
那么我们同时现在把东盟国家的一些学校培养老师学生，专门我们亚龙在东盟要招聘200名，还有可以有的学生可以到中国来留学。
Now Yalong supported schools students come to Yalong for further study and we can
如果俄罗斯的学校也可以需要到我们中国留学，我们这边也可以。
We are welcome for Russian schools come to Yalong.
今年我去印度。
Mr. Chen come to India.
我印度七月份去了印度，七月份印度驻上海的总领事专门到我们公司里来。
And now the general consul in Shanghai come to visit Yalong in.
啊，就是在印度。
This is Indian.
这是印度的那个印度驻上海的总领事。
Come to Yalong.
我们要求我们为印度服务，这是联合国教科文组织开的第三届。
This is the exhibition.
邀请在我们在会上的掌声。
Yalong has been invited to attend the meeting.
我们中国教育部的副部长鲁迅。那么我希望能够合作。
Now we Yalong want to cooperate with Russian.
上条读一下。你读一下。Yalong
hopes to cooperate with the education, research institutions, engineering educations, and vocational education college of Russia in, together to develop the Russian style curriculum resource. And Yalong hopes to cooperate with Russian together to train professional technical teachers of automation, CNC technology, railway, robots majors, and so on. Yalong hopes to cooperate with Russian to improve and serve Russian engineering education, vocational education, and informationization technology. This is one of the company of Russian who will distribute our products. If you here had an interesting, you can take this catalog.
Yalong
is one of the biggest manufacturer of education training equipment in China.
那么我希望能够跟真情的联合国教科文组织，还有世界各个国家的代表，还有俄罗斯界教育界合作。Yalong
sincerely hope we can cooperate with the Russian in education and serve the.
还有亚龙可以输送这个内容。亚龙
can transfer more excellent curriculum resource, education technology equipment, teacher training, and make contribution to Russian engineering education and vocational education development.
那么我们亚龙所有的设备开发，一个是课程里面包括慕课整个课程，还有老师的对技术技能的培训，还有我们的教育装备，我们全面的可以跟各位代表合作。
We can cooperate with Russia in many fields like curriculum development and skills exchange.
同时希望大家能够有方便的时候来到中国，到我们浙江温州。
And we really welcome all can come to Yalong.
还有我们亚历山大先生，非常感谢这次机会，给我们一个机会，他来过。Thanks to Alexander.
Really thanks for you.
对我们公司访问也指导，我们上次非常高兴，
and thanks for his visiting to Yalong.
感谢大家，谢谢。
Thank you, thank you.
Please, you have done your applauses for Mr. Chen and his charming interpreter lady, especially. Ladies and gentlemen, it was the last presentation. I would like to thank very much for all our speakers in our plenary session to how ICT can contribute to improving the quality of education and training. The presentation of our speakers were in very high quality. If you have some question, some recommendation concerning the final document,
you have given to me or to Professor Khorushilov. Now I shall offer 20-minute coffee break, and 5 o'clock, there will be closing ceremony and adoption and conference final document. Thank you very much.
Дорогие коллеги, друзья, мы подошли к завершающему пункту нашей программы, нашей повестки дня. Хочу отметить, что работали все очень хорошо, и многие участники отметили, что, видимо, в будущем возможно проводить подобные конференции больше, чем за 2 дня, потому что многие хотели ознакомить и познакомиться с результатами тех проектов, исследований, которые здесь были представлены. Мы подготовили очень краткий проект рекомендаций нашей конференции. Сделали мы это умышленно, чтобы мы могли получить от вас какие-то дополнения и замечания, и затем уже сделать финальный документ нашей конференции с учетом всех пожеланий и замечаний, которые мы получим от участников. Но прежде я хочу предоставить слово модераторам тематических секций, которые расскажут нам о тех вопросах и, возможно, также упомянут те рекомендации, предложения, которые были высказаны во время работы тематических секций. Пожалуйста, Светлана.
So I discussed our conclusions with co-chairpersons of the sections 1 and 4. And our conclusions are as follows. Well, I speak English so that you can listen to me without translation and maybe correct me if I sum up something wrong. So the program of sections 1 and 4 was very intense. Both speakers and moderators had to work hard to keep the schedule. In addition to content-based recommendations that will be provided later, it is advised to ensure more balanced regional representation of participants and probably arrange parallel sessions to have room for questions and answers. At section 1, digital electronic resources and open education, we discussed different issues related to open educational resources, massive open online courses, and electronic textbooks. The papers from Japan, Spain, Russia, Uzbekistan, and a speaker from IPTS, European Commission, were delivered. It is advised that UNESCO IITE should continue promotion of OER and research in this field, as well as monitoring of the state of the art of OER in various non-English speaking countries. Session 4 was devoted to multimedia, social media, and networks in education. Speakers from Finland, Netherlands, and Russia presented papers of more conceptual character and about some specific smaller scale projects. The recommendation for UNESCO IIT would be to consider the opportunity to undertake to complete country reports to determine the readiness for the promotion of media and information literacy, as well as OER and MOOC, including that would include multimedia and interactive elements.
Спасибо. Maybe some of participants of these thematic sections want to add something. Может быть, кто-то из участников этих тематических секций хочет дополнить или высказать пожелание? Ну, yes, please, Pete. Thank you, Pete. И, конечно, любые замечания, пожелания мы ждем по электронной почте также в ближайшую неделю. Наталья, пожалуйста.
Okay, may I also speak English? First of all, I would like to say that we also had very intensive discussions during our both sections, section number two and section number three. During these sections, first of all, the participants have exchanged experience and discussed emerging approaches and trends of modern information and communication technologies. Among other things, the participants of the section two, for example, focused on improving the quality of education within technical and vocational education and training, engineering education, and higher education. Many innovative approaches were discussed during the section three, including such interesting experience which was accumulated in the Smart University in the United Arab States, Samsung IT school, cloud technologies which were applied in Moldova, Ukraine, and Belarus in inclusive schools, and many, many others. One of the messages from both sections, I suppose, that nowadays we have innovative technologies such as massive online open courses, open educational resources, mobile technologies, cloud technologies as well, but we don't have the correlated, the appropriate methods of assessment the quality of education. Also, we don't have the appropriate pedagogical approaches, and our following task, the task for the future, should be development of pedagogical approaches. Among the participants, there was a feedback that sometimes we need to have a look back, and we need to remember our classical pedagogical traditions. We need to know our basis of pedagogy, and we need to apply such classical pedagogical approaches to new technologies. So we are open, and we will be glad if you will continue our ideas and provide your proposals for our final document for resolution. So, and finally, I would like to thank all of our participants from our sections for their bright, really bright presentations. Thank you.
Спасибо, Наталья. Снова вопрос, again the question. Some remarks, comments, or additions? No. Мы также ждем любые комментарии по электронной почте. Ну и теперь я сам себе предоставляю слово. В отличие от моих коллег, буду говорить по-русски, потому что на нашей секции, в которой принимало участие более 50 участников проекта Learning for the Future, обучение для будущего, и участники решили, что в этот раз рабочий язык на этой секции, которая одновременно явилась форумом ЛФФ, мы будем использовать русский язык, хотя многие презентации также были и на английском языке. Данная секция имела специальный характер, потому что помимо обсуждения проблем использования информационных технологий и новых педагогических методик в школьном образовании, участники представили результаты, которые они получили в рамках реализации пилотного проекта «Обучение для будущего». Необходимо отметить, что в этот раз многие участники представляли не только свои школы, а также и партнеров из других стран, членов ЮНЕСКО, с которыми они совместно реализовывали проекты в рамках трех основных направлений деятельности. Это применение информационных технологий для повышения качества образования, это применение информационных технологий в образовании для устойчивого развития и информационные технологии и новый гуманизм. Во время обсуждений докладов были высказаны несколько предложений. Прежде всего, связанных с тем, что пилотная фаза этого проекта принесла очень интересные результаты, и участники решили, что теперь проект может быть самостоятельным, в который необходимо привлекать как ассоциированные школы внутри стран, участниц пилотной фазы, так и ассоциированные школы из других стран, членов ЮНЕСКО, с которыми участники проекта уже имеют устойчивые связи. Кроме того, было отмечено о том, что на национальном уровне данный проект может реализовываться и в других направлениях, а не только в тех трех, которые мы уже отметили. Также было отмечено, что участники считают очень полезным взаимодействие при координирующем роли Института по информационным технологиям с нашими партнерами из частного сектора, крупными международными и национальными компаниями, работающими в области информационных технологий. И было решено, что в следующем году будет организовано уже по итогам завершения этого проекта встреча в расширенном составе с привлечением других государств, других школ и представителей национальных комиссий и Министерства образования. И очень важно, что было отмечено участниками, что фактически в рамках этого проекта было создано впервые вот такое международное сообщество практики учителей и учащихся ассоциированных школ ЮНЕСКО. И это очень важно. Спасибо. Если есть какие-то дополнения у участников, kindly welcome, if you have some comments. Я понимаю, что все устали, очень работали плотно. Ну и также мне хотелось высказать несколько слов относительно высокого качества докладов, представленных на пленарных заседаниях. Об этом мне сказали также представители университета МЕФИ, который нам оказал содействие в реализации нашей конференции. Многие сотрудники также приняли участие в перерывах между их лекциями или научной работой и отметили очень высокое качество докладов. Также на тематических секциях были очень интересные доклады, которые определили проблемы и современные тенденции в области применения информационных технологий. К сожалению, вот тот формат, который у нас получился, не позволил нам уделить больше внимания дискуссиям. Но я думаю, мы сможем продолжить обсуждение вот этих актуальных тем в рамках уже работы с теми участниками, которые представили свои доклады. Мы постараемся разместить все презентации у нас на нашем сайте института, так же, как и тезисы. Хочу выразить благодарность членам правления нашего института, которые в полном составе приняли самое активное участие в конференции. Также хочется поблагодарить технический персонал, переводчиков, работников блока питания, там, где проходили обеды, ужины и кофе-брейки, и весь коллектив университета МЕФИ. И, конечно, мне очень хотелось поблагодарить сотрудников нашего института, которых на самом деле не так много, у которых есть масса обязанностей и других проектов, которые также имеют свои дедлайны, отчеты, ну, которые последние месяцы работали фактически круглосуточно. Как нас этому учит система электронного обучения. 24 часа в сутки, 7 дней в неделю. Если есть какие-то пожелания, кто-то хочет высказаться, пожалуйста. Don't mention it. Kindly welcome. We just one team, you and we one team. It's more maybe most essential result of our conference. Thank you so much. Спасибо огромное. And I ask the government board members stay for a few minutes here, jointly with our keynote speakers from foreign countries for some advertising. Please stay here. А всем остальным желаю удачного полета домой И скорых встреч. Hope to see you soon. Спасибо вам огромное.